So, good evening, everyone. It's a wonderful evening, actually. I'm sure you will treasure this evening for a long time to come. The topic is a little difficult, so only those who are intellectually capable of analyzing situation and future and life, only they will come. So we will not have a large audience, but we will have select people in the audience. Today we have a guest speaker, Dr. Vishal Bhadani. He is my very close friend, so I will introduce him as a friend rather than an expert on a topic. But still, some of you might be interested in knowing who he is, right? What his qualifications are. So I have a 3-page CV, but I am going to read only the first part of it, right? He is basically an academician, a thinker, a philosopher, a teacher trainer, right? He is also on our Gujarat state board as a trainer. He has written short stories and some special kinds of fiction. One of his books is titled Fictionalai, right? And he has translated novels and stories. If you talk about qualifications, he has an MA in English, an MPhil in English, and a PhD in English, plus BRS. I think it is Rural Studies.
Yeah.
He has taught at a number of colleges. He has conducted training workshops on various topics. Very few people in our field means English language teaching, we call it ELT. Very few people in our field have, you know, conducted programs or given lectures on ELT plus philosophy in education and pedagogy. So he is one of them. Very few people can do that. We will publish probably this video, and along with that we will keep the whole CV also. So if you are interested in reading the books that he has written or he has translated, you can refer to that later. So without further ado, I would invite Dr. Vishal Bhadani.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Am I audible over there?
Okay.
So at the very outset, I would like to thank Fluentlingua and Dr. Dharmendra Sheth for this wonderful opportunity. This is the second day I am speaking on Harari. Yesterday I had an opportunity to talk about his latest book called 21 Lessons for the 21st Century at Vanita Vishram Women's College of Commerce. But this book is quite close to me and all of us because it talks about future. So that's why yesterday we were struggling with the title of the talk, and we came up with this Future Matters because it matters to all of us. So straight away we'll start with the future that has been recently in vogue. People tasted a bit of future with this. I'm sure some of you have tried Face app and tried to see the glimpse of what you look like. However, in the world of philosophy and, you know, thinking, seeing future, making prediction, prophecies has always been there. From Nostradamus in various religions. If you talk about let's say 100 years, some important books we should know. For example, we had a book called Brave New World by Aldous Huxley. We had another interesting book by the Animal Farm writer George Orwell called 1984 was a very interesting book. It was a dystopian kind of a book which talked about very bleak future of humanity, and during 1984 people reread that book and compared the presence with the Prophecies made by George Orwell. Then came an important author that we were discussing. His name is Alvin Toffler. Some of you might have heard of Alvin Toffler, and the name of the book is Future Shock, wherein he talks about how to embrace change, basically. In fact, our ability to embrace change decides the course of lot many things that we do in our life. Alright. So, for some of us, I think introduction of Professor Yuval Noah Harari is important. He has earned his PhD in history from Oxford University. Right now, he is teaching at the Hebrew University of Jerusalem, and his international bestseller. Two important things that I would particularly mention about Harari is, one, he does not use any form of cell phone except his office landline, and second, he spends about 40 days a year doing Vipassana. So this book that we are going to talk about is dedicated to S.N. Goenka, a very big name in Vipassana. So during his interviews, during his talks, he talk about the clarity that he has, and he gives credit to Vipassana a lot. So he became famous with this book, Sapiens, A Brief History of Mankind, wherein he, you know, traces history of sapiens in about, let's say, 70,000 years. He talks about various revolution, agricultural revolution, cognitive revolution. After that, for the first time, a historian or a professor of history is talking about future. I think that's a surprising note that everybody has carefully noted, that somebody from history is going to talk about future. Now, why that is a kind of a very odd yet meaningful relationship? Because to my mind, history ushers light forward from the behind. It's like you're walking on a road and there's a car coming from behind and it ushers a way forward. And think of a situation, a car is coming in front of you. It will probably dazzle your eyes. In philosophy, they say that probably the only way to gain knowledge is the hindsight, is to look back. So why Harari's discussions on future rings bell to everybody is because he has that clarity of the past. So that is Homo Deus. We are going to talk about it. And the latest book is 21 Lessons for the 21st Century. This is about presence, like what is happening right now. And he is giving us a big picture about terrorism, war, education. And at last, he mentions resilience. So Homo Deus begins where Sapiens ends, and that is how human beings, how Homo sapiens are going to be insignificant, right? So this is the book. The meaning of this word Homo Deus, literally it means God-man. Okay, it means God-man. And very interesting title, A Brief History of Tomorrow. In Sapiens we have seen the title is A Brief History of Mankind. Now it is Brief History of Tomorrow. So that basically three parts. Part one deals with how Homo sapiens conquers the world. Part two deals with how we gave meaning to this world. And part three, which is the main argument of the book, how we are going to lose the control of this world that we have literally labored to control over. Let's get start with this. So till 20th century, these were the three agenda that we wanted to take absolute control over. Before 20th century, we were struggling as a race. We could not have any answer to these three things: famine, war, and plague. To give some data from Homo Deus, Harari says that between 1692 and 1695, that almost 20% of world's population died because of plague. So people were, at any given day, were afraid of such epidemic diseases like plague. And even today, you know, situations like war is like always being talked about, or we are always on the verge of war in every country. And famine, even today people die with starvation. However, Harari says that we have controlled these three things. How? Let's look at some data. In 2010, 1 million people were killed by malnutrition. But the staggering data is that 3 million people were killed by obesity. So on a lighter tone, he says that your chances of dying off because of McDonald's and Coca-Cola are way higher than starvation. Secondly, war, if you look at the data on war and the data on, let's say, suicide, the disparity. So the suicide rate is increasing, whereas we have controlled, at least on the number of deaths, we have controlled that. And plague and other epidemics like Ebola, for example, imagine the 20% population dying, and imagine 11,000 people dying in 2014. So this data tells us that we have controlled the world. We have accomplished this agenda. And then Harari says, what are the 21st century agenda? The first and the most surprising, shocking, amazing agenda is immortality. And that is defeating death. Defeating death has always been pursuit of humanity. At least it has been the promise that has been given to us by spiritual leaders, that you, if you do X thing, you will attain immortality. Second is happiness, key to happiness, right to happiness that we want to achieve. And third is divinity, and that is upgrade from sapiens to Homo Deus. From this living or organic entities, we will become Homo Deus and we will outperform gods. How? Let's look at one by one each of these agenda. First is defeating death. Harari argues that why do people die? He says that death is a technical failure. Why do you die? So the organs are parts in the body that stop functioning and you die. What if you can know which part of your body organ is going to be dysfunctional? You can repair it, replace it. And by that, along with Harari, many scientists are making predictions that the average human lifespan is going to be between 150 years to 200 years. So there is this project we should know that Harari mentioned. It's called Calco. It's a sub company of Google. And if you read the vision statement of this company, it says to solve death. Right? In the next part of the discussion, we will come back to this, how they are doing it. Second is right to happiness. Once we are done with our basics, the natural pursuit is of happiness and stable happiness. So we know from Bhutan that now from GDP, we should move to GDH, that is gross domestic happiness. And according to science, happiness is equal to sensation. If you can manipulate sensations, you can control happiness. And this is the argument, and probably we'll have more discussions on it. ADHD, we know. Today in the USA, 57% children are taking medicine for ADHD, and these children are not suffering from ADHD. This is surprising. Why are they taking this medicine? Because they want to increase the performance. By drugs, we can manipulate the hormones, and by way of this hormonal manipulation maneuvers, we will be happy. That's what Harari says. And third is divinity. How do we become gods? So there's a beautiful comparison he gives, that why do we go to gods? For three primary reasons: rain, protection, and fertility. He says if you pay to MNCs which are doing or which will do these three things, you will probably not require any God. Secondly, our gods can only create organic entities. But Homo Deus, humans can create non-organic entities as well. So he asks, can God create software? Our God? Can he or she create robots? We can, right? So by this logic, we will perform in future by, he says, 2050 or so, we will have new kinds of beings. Maybe beings with synthetic body, with human soul. We don't know what's happening. But the path that he is indicating us is clearly leading to that. Now, to become Homo Deus, the process of data data processing, we have been processing data so far on our own, right? If you look at Sapiens, right, why did we conquer this world? It's because of two things. One is our ability to process data at a massive scale, and second is to coordinate flexibly. These are the reasons why we could conquer the world. Now, it gives a very interesting analogy of a monkey. Suppose there is a monkey, and monkey sees a bunch of bananas, and there's a lion standing nearby. Now, the monkey has to calculate the probabilities, his speed of running to the bananas, his appetite, lion's speed of reaching to the monkey. So these probabilities, so in a spur of a moment, the monkey calculates that and makes the decision. So Harari says that this processes can be outsourced. If someone else does this processing for you, there are chances for your survival and in fact beating the negative probabilities. So he says that our entire body is a calculator, and this calculator, human can guess maximum probabilities and rule the planet, yeah? Which other animals have very limited way of calculating their probabilities. From that, we move to part second, that after gaining that probability, that calculation, coordinating flexibly. In Sapiens also he mentions that you cannot make 50 donkeys or other animals to coordinate for a single purpose, which is very it's everyday for us, that you can ask 1,000 people, even 1,00,000 people to do one particular task. Okay, so how did we do this later on after agriculture revolution? We have invented certain things. One of them is writing, and he strongly argues that writing is something that is required to, that's in an algorithmic fashion, right? Now, how does it help? Writing is used to validate reality. And that's why, we have holy scriptures, and in quotes, we take oath by them, right? Because it is written, it is real. So Harari says that anybody who can invent meaning and ascribe it to certain system of writing can rule the world. And we have organized society, and we have coined posts which matter more than your personality type, your genetic code. For example, you go to a bank, so the manager's post is more important than what his caste is, what his gender is, right? Another important point that he makes in this section is the invention of fiction. He says that fiction is more powerful than truth. Fiction is more powerful than truth in the sense that it enables us to cooperate better. And the best example is money. Money is the story that we have collectively agreed upon. And we remember what happens if someday all of us technically stop to agree on certain currency. Let's say demonetization is the day to end certain story of certain currency. Right? So you need fictional rules to play a game, right? Suppose you want to play football, you need to invent rules, and all of us can play that game. So is true with any organization. So is true with any society. So Harari says that all societies are governed by these fictional rules. Now next thing is, any great power that wants to rule the world has to invent a fiction and make people believe in that. And he gives examples of elections. He says that elections are a matter of human emotions than rationality. And if you want to trigger human emotions, so far we have used fiction to make people believe in a story. And when they believe, they will vote for you. Otherwise, they will not think rationally. They will not calculate X tasks performed by parties. So now the shift that he is indicating is this, that previously we said that God helps those who help themselves. Now we are saying that even if you don't have faith on, let's say, anesthesia, it will still work on you. If you don't have faith on antibiotics, they will still work on you. So that faith element is not required, that faith on the fiction. Previously, we said that plague was caused by some mysterious god. So we used to go to churches, temples, mosques and prayed, right? Later on, we realized that, okay, it's a bacteria. We should stop believing in that fiction of mysterious god and let's observe closely what's happening. So after discussing all that, he reveals and makes a big statement, and he says that there is no cosmic plan, there is no grand design that is working. Everything is here and now, and from the perspective of capitalism, from the perspective of governance, it is this economic development that will blur the boundaries. And the best example that he gives is of China. And he quotes Xi Jinping. He says, it does not matter if a cat is black or white, so long as it catches the mice. And we see this happening even in India in a big way. The previous caste system is collapsing, and the tools of blurring the caste boundaries are willy-nilly from capitalism, right? It neutralizes them. Secondly, what will happen, Harari says, is that our ethical ground is being compromised. And there's a beautiful example he gives, that there's a employee in Silicon Valley, and he has aged father he has to take care of. Now the company's rules and regulations don't allow him to take very good care of his father. So the company says, company advises to the to the employee that, okay, we have many people from Mexico, the refugees, and they are in need of work. Why don't you hire a caretaker for your father, right? So now that is the choice which has been implanted by the corporate to the employee, and it is going to be a big challenge, Harari says, in future, for another reason, that imagine the lifespan increases from, like, today 70 to 150. What will happen to relationships? What will happen to careers? What will happen to the population? These are the challenges that he is. So family and ecology can be sacrificed, and is being sacrificed. So this economic will, economic development right now is never stopping will. Harari says that right now these changes are occurring at such a big scale that right now there is not a single power that can control it and that can regulate it or stop it. So he says that previously, in the previous story, we have been governed by free will. Like we have seen in 20th century, the rise, development and stability of the liberal story. What is a liberal story? That we are governed by free will. What is free will? That I, me and myself. What I should wear, which religion I should follow, whom to marry, everything is decided by me. So he calls it humanist revolution. And he says that of late we have realized that human feelings are at the center of the universe. There is no God, because he has already said that there is no cosmic plan. If human feelings are at the center, what are the ramifications on different fields? And we have seen first is on ethics. So my feeling is always right. That's why gay and lesbian relationships have become legal. Because people have realized that, okay, it's fine if he wants to marry of the same gender person, it's fine, right? We have allowed it, which was probably an impossible sort of a phenomenon, let's say 50 years back, 100 years back. But because we have believed in free will, that was possible. Second is politics. Voter is always right. Do whatever you like to do, but voter will tell you whether you're going to rule or not. Again, voters' free will. Third is humanist economy. Customer is always right. This is the point wherein he elaborates in detail. And he says, let's say there's a car company that wants to build the best car in the world. And it brings on the board Nobel laureates, Oscar winner, artists and everybody. And they come out with the best car. They launch the car and nobody buys it. Why? Because customer doesn't like it. You can't go and tell to the customer that you don't have sense of what a good car is. Nobody can say, right? And if somebody comes to you, let's say, what would be your response? You say, it's my money. I will decide, right? Who are you to tell me what to do? So that's why service industry is in boom, right? Service industry is the foundation is here. Same is for humanist art, right? We know this, beauty lies in the eyes of beholder. And there's a famous example of an artist. He built urinal, basically, that basin. And he said, this is art. Now, can we say it is not? And what are the grounds for denying that this is not art? There are no scientific parameters of considering something artistic or non-artistic. And even today, the replica of that piece, the name of that piece is probably Fountain. And replica of that art piece has been placed in perhaps 6 biggest museums in the world, right? So that's art, and probably that's why today, like if there are 25 people sitting in this auditorium, all of us, we have different perception of music, what a good music is. Lastly, humanist education. So previously we thought that, okay, teacher should decide how to teach, what to teach. But now we are saying that student, the aim of education is to make students think for themselves. Again, to make them independent thinkers, free will. Okay, so this is how he presents the idea of free will. This is the actual image of people trying it on soldiers. Two experiments. One is with the army officials or the soldiers of US Army. Second, of the soldiers of Jerusalem. They were feeling, I mean, we know that soldiers have this post-war trauma. They have great anxiety of killing and bloodshed and that. So that has a very bad impact on their body. So they were struggling how to get rid of it. So they implanted a chip and a device over here. So whenever you feel this kind of trauma and anxiety, you have to press a button. And this button will release anti-stress chemical in your brain and you are stress-free. You don't have to attend now. In future, you don't have to attend stress management courses and seminars. So one interesting example he gives that in a Jerusalem hospital, one soldier turned up and said, your device is not working, it has stopped. Why don't you check? So the doctors checked and they found out the device that they had implanted here, the battery died. They replaced the battery and device was okay. Yeah. So this is the era of manipulating thoughts. Another significant argument Harari makes is the decoupling, separation of intelligence from consciousness. These are the two genuinely beautiful gifts that God has given to us. Humans are not only extremely intelligent species, but they are conscious also. Now, Harari says that at the moment, AI is focusing on intelligent part. It's not focusing on consciousness. And it's not required also. How? says that non-conscious algorithms are far more accurate than humans in many tasks such as driving cars, diagnosing diseases or identifying terrorists. They are far accurate. And we have seen it. Those of us who are using GPS, right? Previously we used to, we used to have a kind of odd relationship with GPS. At times we disbelieved GPS and we believed in our gut feelings. And 50% chances were right. But gradually, GPS is getting better and better and better. So Harari says that AI is not an enemy to human. And for any AI to rule humans, it has to be better than average human being. If AI is better than average human being, it will rule us. Because that's the common, average IQ of the planet. It is because all these tasks require pattern recognition. And we are saying in a big way. The moment you will leave this auditorium, many of you will receive an SMS. How was your experience with Yogi Ayurveda? Rate us. Right? Pattern recognition. They are recognizing. They are following you. If pattern recognizing is outsourced, right now we are recognizing, previously, right now many of the tasks, in fact most of the tasks that we perform on a daily basis have been taken over by gadgets. But if there is a next stage, think of a Google car network driverless. Today, Harari says, annually 1.2 million people die in road accidents. And 85% of these road accidents are because of human errors. Now you outsource this, right? When you outsource it, you will rely more on this. And there are these chances of driverless cars colliding with one another are less. How? Because it's not so many drivers that are driving the car, so many systems. It's only one system. So imagine a juggler who's playing with 10 bottles. None of them crash. Why? Because it's one person who is controlling 10 things. So if there is one system that can control lakhs of cars, the chances of accidents are less and we can save lives on a positive note. Example 2, what will happen if this pattern recognition is outsourced? Computer algorithm correctly diagnosed 90% of lung cancer while human doctors could diagnose 50%. This is an experiment in the US. Now take your own case. You go to a doctor and you go for diagnosis of certain cancer and doctor says, well, you don't have any cancer, just chill. And you chill for 5-7 years because of the wrong diagnosis. And then one fine day you discover that, oh my God, I'm on the third stage. Then either you are doomed or doomed economically. The two probabilities. What if software tells you exactly whether you have it or you don't have it? You will go for the treatment. Look at this mistaken prescriptions, 50 million per year. And we can imagine situations in India. One of the significant criterion for deciding human intelligence is chess, right? That if anybody is playing chess, we think that, oh, he's intelligent, he's good for your mental gymnastics. But this dates back to 1966, when IBM software Deep Blue defeated then world champion Garry Kasparov, okay? But 2014, there's another very interesting incident. They have updated Deep Blue and they call it Stockfish 8. Then Google came out with another software, another program called AlphaZero. They organized a match between two software. Okay. Now, keep in mind, for acquiring this ability, we took 70,000 years. Okay. Out of 100 matches, 78 were ties and 20 matches were won by Google AlphaZero. Now, the interesting part is Google AlphaZero took only 4 hours to learn chess. 70,000 years, 4 hours. this is the beginning of AI and Homo Deus. So the threat part is this. 20th century has taken our physical abilities. We have outsourced the labor work. So the farmer who was manually farming went on to using tractor. Yeah, but still farmer was not jobless. He had the job. Secondly, he did not had to undergo rigorous training to learn how to drive a tractor. He could manage it. So then right now all of us are doing some of these tasks which require cognitive abilities. Cognitive abilities means pattern recognition. Yeah. So now if this is taken over by AI, Harari says there will be rise of useless class and we have no idea what will happen. This is a report he cites that in next 15 to 20 years, which professions are going to go obsolete, extinct. This percentage, they are probabilities. So 99% human telemarketers will go. 98% sport referees. And we know a bit of this happening in cricket. 97% cashiers, we know, teller machine. And of course, a very interesting portion of this book is about taxation on digital currency and digital transactions. So we will require a new brigade of accountants and policies. We have to rewrite our policies. Chefs, something that we thought that, uske aatho mein jadoo hai. No, that jadoo can be decoded now. That's a pattern. Waiters, tour guides, bakers, 89% bus drivers. If Google can drive a car, it can safely drive a bus as well. Construction laborers, something that is hardcore, real, physical. Even that can be. And we have seen, certain magical products of 3D printing. And 72% carpenters. This, he puts into a perspective. He says that there are three things we should remember. All living organisms are algorithms. So right now we are known by names, but in future we'll be known by codes, our barcode. That recently, and right now, if you ask who are you on Facebook, Facebook knows you by code. Okay. Second is, algorithm is not affected by the materials from which the calculator is built. If you say 2 plus 2 is equal to 4 by thinking or by calculating with a machine, it doesn't matter. We are interested in the result. Third, there is no reason to think that the organic algorithm can do things that non-organic algorithm will never be able to replicate or surpass. So, when I talk about Harari with friends, and most of them are into education, some of them, invariably will pop up and say, no, but, teachers can't be replaced by machines. There is no human touch, right? They would come with this. They will never. Harari says, this never has an expiry date now. Never means 20 years or 30 years. It will happen. And the benefit with digital teacher is, there are 40 students in the classroom. That digital teacher will invent 40 different styles of teaching. So I will have my personal style of learning. Secondly, the digital teacher will never get angry on me. How nice. He or she will, or I will say it. It will not humiliate me. If I fail to learn by X method, it will invent 10 different methods. That's the best part. These are real life examples of AI human cooperation. There's a MNC, a pharmaceutical MNC in Hong Kong. It has put on board this software called Vital in its board of decision makers. In every meeting, Vital sits and they ask Vital, that Vital, we are planning to launch this medicine, what are your views? So in no time, Vital would say, well, I have a data of 10,000 pharmaceuticals companies in this world. Right now they're working on these areas. In last 6 months, they have launched these types of medicines. These are the results And based on this, my suggestion is this. So out of 6, one member is AI. Actually, okay, people thought music is something related to our feelings. Humans can, I mean, software can never compose music. There are wonderful experiments. It's called EMI, experiments in music industry. And software have composed music, and you will never be able to distinguish whether it is composed by software or human. Same with poetry. Both these experiments have been conducted by the same person. He's a professor of musicology at Stanford. This is the name of the book. Comes the Fiery Night, 2000 Haiku by Man and Machine. In this book, nowhere it is written who is the author. Nowhere. And the professor invites you. If you can distinguish, if you can identify, okay, this one is by machine and this one is by a man. So that creative field is also under threat. There is a very interesting chapter named 87% probability. We have seen this in media, even Time has taken note of this. Angelina Jolie's mother and grandmother both died of breast cancer. So, no, thinking that I might have that, she went for test, DNA test. Other medical reports, all other medical reports said you are fine. There is not a single chance of your having breast cancer, but she went for this test. After the test result came, she put the test results into big data. What is the big data? All the women that had ever went for, had ever gone for this kind of test. And the big data analyzed, compared and produced a result, which said that with all, when I compared your data with other data, the result is you have 87% chances of breast cancer, which no other medical reports gave to her. So what to do? So she went for surgery, which is very costly right now, and she published this in all media platforms for the awareness. Now imagine something that AI can tell you which is related to your life and death. Won't you choose that? That's the question. Some upcoming big projects that Harari mentions. Project number one is Google Flu Trend. Now what is Google Flu Trend? Google Flu Trend is, suppose you are working with a company, you wake up one fine morning and you have a hangover, you have a headache, you write to your HR manager that since I have a headache, I won't be able to come. And that email is something that Google wants. So Google will check how many such emails have been shot today. Is there any flu coming up? That data Google will share with your software doctor, which then evaluate your existing medical report that software has already has, okay, and then will suggest whether your headache is caused by any flu or it is a regular one, or probably the last night food, and probably send you the medicine via drone. Okay, so one of the predictions is about GP. The first jobs that we will lose will be general physicians. They won't be required, and already in Mumbai, in fact, there is one software under construction. Suppose you have a headache, and so you are not the only worst person having headache. So there are 2 crore people in the world who had headache and they had taken certain medicines, so that they will then smartly, you know, prioritize the impact of certain medicines. So then tell you that out of 2 crore, let's say 50 lakhs have been benefited by this medicine, 30 lakhs by this medicine, 20 lakhs by this medicine. You decide now. So then based on your symptoms, you know, you can go for that. Google Fit is clothes, bracelets, shoes, glasses to collect your biochemical data live. If you wear this, these system, Google Fit will upload your data live on cloud. And based on that, you know, in fact, there is a bracelet available which can tell you that with existing biochemical processes, when will you die? This is the company started by ex-wife of the person who started Google. It's called 23andMe. It's called genome test at 99. When you go for genome test, they'll also tell you so many things that other medical tests cannot tell you. 23, because there are 23 pairs of DNA, right? So we are going at micro. Harari says this is for the first time. Now external controlling is over. Now we have to focus inside. What if algorithms knows me more than I know myself? So there's a story. Just to indigenize, I have selected this picture. So there's this girl and two boys are courting her. And she likes both of them with certain degree of variation. Suppose Alia Bhatt likes Siddharth Malhotra 51% and to Varun Dhawan 49%. Okay, she's unable to decide. According to free will, her own choice is Siddharth Malhotra. But given the algorithm, she would ask Google that whom should I marry? So Google says, well, Alia, I have all the data of you ever since you were born. In fact, before you were born. Your medical reports, your social media accounts, I know your friends, I know what kind of food you have, I know what kind of shopping, what kind of cosmetics you use. And based on that, and I also know that you want me to tell you that you should go for Siddharth Malhotra. But as I know you, I know both these boys also. And their family members and your family members, when I see the combinations of all these things, your probability, your chances of happy married life goes well with Varun Dhawan. Now you decide. Now this is the juncture, still there is a distance. That AI is still descriptive, not prescriptive. It will just show the situation. Now you decide. If you had selected doctor in software in case of your cancer, you are most likely to select algorithm and rely on algorithm for your relationship as well. You will stop believing. You know, as we go for online shopping, we see this, that most customers bought this together. Most customers bought this together. Now, this is where we are heading. So, if imagine your medicine, your relationships, if that is taken over. There's another experiment that Facebook has carried out called Facebook algorithm on 86,220 people. Who are the people that, you know, they know you the best in our life? Who are these people? First, our friends, second, family members, and third, our life partners. If Facebook has 70 likes, I mean, if I have liked 70 video, photographs, somebody's status, it is enough for Facebook to outperform my friends about who am I, right? Facebook can better tell you whether I am a reliable person or not than my friends. It requires 150 likes to outperform your family members and 300 likes to outperform your life partners. Okay, so we are going towards accuracy of genetic code. Now, these are systems in place which are already there. Waze is a GPS system. It is better than GPS in many ways. For example, if there are, let's say, 1000 people going to Mumbai by car, and if all of them are using Waze, Waze will smartly distribute them and it will lessen traffic. It will save your time. Second, if you say, well, on the way I want to have hospital, so Waze will guide you through that path. If you want to say, I want to have natural sceneries, so Waze will take you to that. Okay, so your traffic navigation, you don't have to rely only on GPS. Right now GPS is point A to B, or with toll, without toll, right? But this is better. Cortana is our digital assistant, which is already there in laptop, and it is becoming better and better and better. So it is recording everything we do on digital platform anywhere. So in future, for applying job, you don't have to send your CV. Just get your Cortana, talk to the employer's Cortana. Same for relationship, matchmaking, your marriage. Let the boy's Cortana talk to the girl's Cortana. And medicine. Let the patient's Cortana talk to the doctor's Cortana. Yeah. Kindle, and this is the example, a very famous example that Harari has given us, that first time in the human history, books are reading humans. Otherwise, we read books, but with face recognition software installed or aligned with the face recognition, this camera thing, Kindle knows what are the lines that, you know, you liked, that made you cry, that made you happy, that laughed, or that bored you. After you read three books on Kindle, Kindle is at the best place to guide the fourth book. Now imagine Kindle is aligned with all other things, like Cortana, like Waze, like your doctor, like Google Fit. It will tell you exactly what kind of stuff you would like to read. And the last part, Harari says, is the birth of a new religion called dataism. Because we have already said there is no God. We have already said that this rise of Homo Deus. If dataism, why dataism? Because right now there is so much of data on the planet that human brain can never analyze, process it and find out the best. It is impossible for a single human to do it. That's why there are four methods he suggests that you will have. Number one, increasing number of processors. You know, and no wonders in future we will be voting to processors rather than political parties. Secondly, increasing the variety of processors. For example, there's a processor as a government, and its political manifesto says that, see, if you vote for our processor, we'll take care of your health, your relationship and your purchase. Please vote for us. Increasing the number of connections between the processors. Then, you know, like political parties, you will have allies, Gathbandhan. And third and very fourth and very important is increasing the freedom of movement along with connection. It's not only important to build a highway between Ahmedabad and Surat, but it's also for the government to take care of the travelers that no robbers are there. Right? So if there are no hackers in between, the data that we are uploading is safe. What is the output of dataism? That is IoT, Internet of Things. When everything is connected, your dog, your tree, your food, your washing machine, and your doctor. And then everything is connected, there is no required for you to be there. If there is no horse, carriage, horses are not required. So then so horses don't go extinct, they become irrelevant. So humans will not go extinct, humans will become irrelevant. So Harari says, how do we empower dataism? He says, for empowering more data, because more the data, better is accuracy for anything. So he says, please record, upload and share. What will happen to humanism? Now this is beautiful, this is the best part. It says, we said in humanist revolution that God is a product of human imagination. It's nothing more than that. So just now ignore him, avoid him. So we shifted from God to man. Center of the universe is nothing but man. Now in algorithm, the era of algorithm says that human imagination is a product of biochemical algorithms. So ignore humans, focus on data. Dataism will rule. Previously we said that humans are sacred because they are created by God. They're so sacred animals. Humanism said humans are sacred on their own and God doesn't exist at all. On their own we are intelligent. I mean, on our own we are intelligent. Today we say IoT is sacred because humans have created it. You know, people would like to brag about their innovations, that I have developed this software. Then dataism will say that IoT is sacred on its own and humans don't exist at all. Right? Now that's the punch. Some questions Harari asked, and these are very, very disturbing questions that our next generation will face. Question number one, do religious scriptures provide answers to biotechnology and algorithms? So Harari is discouraging us believing in scriptures. Those popular stories, you know, that said that all the answers of human problems lie in scriptures. So Harari said that if I have a problem in algorithm, can any scripture tell me how to code, or problem with C language or Java or PHP? What will be the political impact of economically useless class? Imagine India's, right now we are experiencing recession, unemployment, which is just a tip of the iceberg. With AI, billions of people will be jobless and we don't know what to do. So probably, like we have Gaushala, cattle farm, we might have human farms with universal basic survival things to be given to them. What will happen to family structure if life extends to 150 years? Harari says that probably at 70 you divorce your husband or wife and you might marry to a non-organic entity. You might marry, and there is no surprise, like we have already Hollywood movies about it, that human robot relationship. Also, the implication for 150 years, right now our life is organized in two parts. First part is dedicated to earning, making a career, and then there is retirement. With this, what will happen? 100 plus people will be employable or not? That's a question. What will happen to the unprecedented gap between the rich and the poor? As we very well know that all the great technologies are initially for the benefit of the riches. By the time they come to the poor, either, you know, it's too, I mean, the quality is too poor, or we are too late to enjoy the privileges.